lot to cover. Let's turn in our Bibles to Ezekiel 17. We continue our study through Ezekiel with a study in Ezekiel 17 and 18. Title of our study, God's Sovereignty and Man's Responsibility. These two chapters deal with two sides of the same coin. Chapter 17 will deal with God's sovereignty, while chapter 18 deals with man's responsibility. It's important because we believe both, but not everyone does. And I know that this is a strategy of the enemy to question what's true, to get us debating and discussing and arguing over what's true. And you know what ends up happening? We're too busy talking about the truth to simply obey it. And again, God's sovereignty, absolutely throughout the scripture, we'll see it clearly. I mean, and you see it in everything. He sovereignly chose to create Adam and Eve. He sovereignly chose to clothe them and cleanse them and restore them after they sinned against him. He sovereignly gave Israel the land. But man's responsibility, we see that too. Adam and Eve had to obey the Lord, and when they didn't, they died spiritually. They broke fellowship with God. And then he made a way back. That's his grace, his mercy, his kindness. And then in the giving of the land to Israel, God sovereignly chose that land and promised it to them. What was their responsibility? Believe him and enter in. And we see it again and again. One whole generation failed to do either. They didn't enter in because they didn't enter in by faith. They just didn't believe it would work, that they could do it. The next generation, however, believed the Lord, obeyed the Lord, and inherited their inheritance. So there's no questioning that the Bible reveals that God is sovereign. He is all-powerful, he's all-knowing, and he is, in fact, in control. But it doesn't change the fact that we are responsible to him. So Satan's strategy again, divide and conquer. God says, hey, here's what I want you to know. I've chosen you. I've made promises to you. I have plans for you. Our part is to believe God as Abe did, and he accounts that to us for righteousness. But our faith in him can only be demonstrated to one another by our obedience to him. See, God can look on my heart. He knows if I love him. He knows if I trust him. He knows everything about us. But people only see what's going on outwardly. And so if we're not to argue over the truth, and we're not, a servant of the Lord must not quarrel. I need to put that one on my fridge and on my, my everything. But I do want to say, I'm far less quarrelsome these days than I was when I was young. I can't blame it on testosterone, because women quarrel a lot too, and I don't think you have a testosterone issues. But the point is, the more we mature, and this is, I hope, true for all of you, the more we mature, the less arguing makes sense to us. Even if you win the argument, sometimes you lose the friend, or you lose the opportunity to just love somebody and say, I know they're wrong and I think they're crazy, but if I tell them they're wrong and crazy, they won't listen to me anymore. So just a bit of encouragement. Well, we have really two sections in this first part of our study tonight. That we begin with the eagle and the vine. That's in the first 10 verses. And then, well, we're going to see in verses 11 through 24, he'll explain what's gone before. He actually shares this section, or these concepts, in what he calls riddles and parables. You'll probably recall Jesus was fond of this methodology as it would draw many to him. Someone telling a story is far more interesting than someone just stating facts. Though when Jesus told stories, he used facts. He told us things we could never learn or know otherwise. He stuck with facts, but he did it in a very engaging way. And often he used riddles or parables and such. And when his disciples asked, well, what are you doing that for? Well, it was interesting because his explanation almost sounds like he didn't want people to hear or understand. You know, seeing they'll see, but not see, and hearing they'll not hear unless they understand. But here's the point. There was always a group he was speaking to, and then as he would go and depart, there were a group that followed him. So the parables, the riddles, those types of teaching, they would draw some in, and others say, guy's crazy, you know, let's go. And so those who wanted to know more always had access to that information, because traditionally, typically, Jesus would tell a story and his disciples would be there nodding like, yep, that's right, that's right. Then they'd get in the house and go, hey, what were you talking about out there? Because, you know, they don't want anybody to know they don't know. And then he would explain it to them. Well, that's what happens here. First 10 verses, the riddle, the parable, verses 11 through 24, he will explain them. Look there with me, chapter 17, verse 1. The word of the Lord came to me saying, son of man, pose a riddle and speak a parable to the house of Israel and say, thus says the Lord God. A great eagle with large wings and long pinions, full of feathers and various colors, came to Lebanon and took a cedar from the highest branch. He cropped off its topmost young twig and carried it to the land of trade. He set it in a city of merchants. He took some of the seed of the land and planted it in a fertile field. He placed it by abundant waters and set it like a willow tree. And it grew and became a spreading vine of low stature. Its branches turned toward him, but its roots were under it. So it became a vine, brought forth branches and put forth shoots. But there was another great eagle with large wings and many feathers. And behold, this vine bent its roots toward him and stretched out its branches toward him. From the garden terrace where it had been planted, that he might water it. It was planted in good soil by many waters to bring forth branches, bear fruit, and become a majestic vine. Say, thus says the Lord God. Will it thrive? Will he not pull up its roots, cut off its fruit, and leave it to wither? All of its spring leaves, will wither. And no great power or many people will be needed to pluck it up by its roots. Behold, it is planted. Will it thrive? Will it not utterly wither? When the east wind touches it, it will wither in the garden terrace where it grew. Now, this is a side issue, but I'll bring it to your attention just for a moment. If we were to try to figure out at this point who's the first eagle and who's the second eagle and what's going on here with this vine, and it would be easy, even among biblical scholars, to come up with multiple options, because this scenario plays itself out again and again in their lives. And once you see the principles, you can say, well, it could be a reference to this or to those but here's what we know. He goes on to tell us. And most of the time, when people have shown me something in Scripture, and you know, I've shared with you, when people come up and they say something about the Scripture, I'm like, oh, really? Show me it in the Scripture. And sometimes people actually have a Bible. I prefer that, by the way. If you want to discuss the Scripture, bring a Bible and say, well, look, I'm reading this, and I think it means this. But more often than not, I can't say 90 out of 100, I just, more often than not, if we just read down a little further or read back right before the part that's confusing them, the explanation's there. And so the key to understanding anything we read is the context in which we find it. We know this book is about God's people, Israel, who've rebelled against him. The northern kingdom's gone into captivity. The Babylonians have taken some of the children of Israel captive as well. Ezekiel among them. Daniel, who we'll study next as well. But there are still some living back in Jerusalem and hoping that the city will survive and that they'll survive with it. And all these things we're reading are saying that's not going to work out. So I bring this to your attention only to say, if you're reading and you come across the verse, and sometimes I do this, I think we all do it, we're reading, but we're not really paying that close of attention, then something pops out at us, and we're like, whoa, what does that mean? Just read back a little, start at the beginning of the paragraph or the section, and then read beyond a little and see if God doesn't show you exactly what he's saying. Well, he does that here, and so it's a perfect way to make the point. That's why I'm sharing it here with you. Moreover, he says, verse 11, the word of the Lord came to me saying, say now to the rebellious house, do you not know what these things mean? Tell them, indeed, the king of Babylon went to Jerusalem and took its king and princes and led them with him to Babylon. And he took the king's offspring, made a covenant with them, and put him under an oath. He also took away the mighty of the land, that the kingdom might be brought low and not lift itself up, but that by keeping his covenant, it might stand. But he rebelled against him by sending his ambassadors to Egypt, that they might give him horses and many people. Will he prosper? Will he who does such things escape? Can he break a covenant and still be delivered? As I live, says the Lord God, surely in the place where the king dwells, who made him king, whose oath he despised and whose covenant he broke with him in the midst of Babylon, he shall die. Well, he says the king of Babylon came and took Jerusalem, came to Jerusalem and took its king and princes and led them with him to Babylon. This is a reference to the king of Babylon taking King Jehoiakim, stripping of his crown, taking him to Babylon. Verse 13, he made the king's offspring, that will be Zedekiah. He made a covenant with him and put him under oath. And so what he does is he says, look, I'm taking your dad, we're going here. I'll leave you behind, you can rule and reign, but here's how it's gonna work. We have a covenant, we have a contract. You make an oath today, you stand by it, things will go well with you. You don't, I'll be back, he says. And in truth, that's what's going to happen. I love that people, after all these years, we still know, you know? And so, I'll be back. I think he's back, he's around. But anyway, So King Jehoiachin, then Zedekiah. And when he asked there in the latter part of verse 15, well, you know, if he goes to Egypt looking to Pharaoh for help, when he's already got a deal with Babylon, who's actually in power, he asked the question, can he break a covenant and still be delivered? And the answer is absolutely no. Not our covenant with God and not our covenant with man. As Jesus says, let your yes be yes and your no be no. So as I live, verse 16, we read it. Surely in the place where the king dwells, who made him king, whose oath he despised, whose covenant he broke with him in the midst of Babylon, he shall die. Many of you know the history. Came back, took Zedekiah captive. Blinded him, and ultimately he dies there in Babylon. Well, verse 17, he goes on to say, nor will Pharaoh with his mighty army and great company do anything in the war when they heap up a siege mound and build a wall to cut off many persons. By the way, they were already told early on, if there are problems in the land, don't trust in horses, don't trust in chariots, don't go back to Egypt. And everything God said not to do, they did. Everything God said to do, they failed to do. And of course, he calls that sin and transgression. Well, all these things he did, and he will not escape. Verses 19 through 21 remind us that rebellion against God's discipline and resulting refusal to repent lead to disaster and death. Check it out, verse 19. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, as I live, surely my oath which he despised and my covenant which he broke, I will recompense on his own head. Get this. The covenant was made between the king of Jerusalem, a king of Judah, and the king of Babylon. But God calls it his covenant and his oath. Why? Because he's the one who brought Nebuchadnezzar against them in the first place. Nebuchadnezzar was his hammer. He was using him, God that is, to discipline them, his own rebellious people. So he says, hey, it was my oath, it was my covenant which he broke, and I'll recompense on his own head. I will spread out my net over him. He shall be taken in my snare. I will bring him to Babylon and try him there for the treason which he committed against me. All his fugitives with all his troops shall fall by the sword, and those who remain shall be scattered to every wind. And as we've seen, the major theme in this book, and you shall know that I, the Lord, have spoken. You shall know that I am the Lord. He says it a few different ways, but he always is saying the same thing. So the discipline came by the hand of God. They refused to repent. They refused to submit to it, and it brought devastation upon them. Thus says the Lord God, verse 22, I will take also one of the highest branches of the high cedar and set it out. I will crop off from the topmost of its young twigs a tender one, and I'll plant it at a high and prominent mountain. On the mountain height of Israel, I will plant it, and I will bring forth boughs. It will bring forth boughs and bear fruit and be a majestic cedar. Under it will dwell birds of every sort. In the shadow of its branches they will dwell, and all the trees of the field shall know that I, the Lord, have brought down the high tree, exalted the low tree, dried up the green tree, and made the dry tree flourish. And I, the Lord, have spoken and have done it. God's grace, God's goodness, God's faithfulness to preserve a remnant in the land, well, it's spelled out once again for us here, and his promise not only to, you know, preserve a remnant, but to restore the repentant. And there would have been many there in Babylon that turned from their sin, trusted in him, found their way home again. Well, three generations historically follow in this scenario. There are multiple possibilities addressed, each related to a reason for their suffering. So let's read together. Chapter 18, verse 1. The word of the Lord came to me again, saying, what do you mean when you use this proverb concerning the land of Israel, saying, the fathers have eaten sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge? We've read this elsewhere, so it's not a brand new concept to us, but what they're saying, in essence, is we're suffering as a result of our father's sin. The fathers ate the sour grapes, but it's the children whose teeth are set on edge. So what they're doing is they're saying, you know what? We're suffering, but it's our father's fault. We're suffering, but it's that generation's fault. And I want to say that's just foolish. And he's going to say that's just foolish. It's so important that we see it. And he'll be as clear as anyone could, as only God can, that they were suffering for their own sin. And listen, I do want to say it's true. We suffer when those around us, especially those closest to us, sin. It's true. If I sin, my boys and my grandkids and my daughter-in-law and my wife, that those people that I have daily contact with, they're most likely to be in the line of fire if I'm out of line. But God isn't punishing them because of my sin. They're just reaping the repercussions of, well, being part of my gene pool and, you know, happy to be stuck with you kind of thing. And so the point I'm making is the scripture doesn't deny that when I sin, it affects everyone around me, and most radically those closest to me. But it's saying that's not God punishing those around me. That they, when they suffer, it will be because of their own sin. And so that's pretty much the theme of this particular chapter. So one thing we tend to do, they certainly did it. It didn't start with them. It goes all the way back to the beginning. But rather than looking inside and then talking to the Lord about, Lord, what's going on here? What have I done? It's not always something we've done, but often it's something we've done that leads to our suffering. They were looking around, and they were trying to figure out whose fault is it that we're suffering? And it's easy to blame others. It's harder to accept the blame ourselves, but that's the best place to look, you see. You remember, we all know, so we don't have to spend any time on it, but at the temptation, Adam blamed Eve, and he blamed God, saying, the woman you gave me. Eve blamed the serpent. I don't remember the serpent blaming anyone. He might have been the only person honest in that moment, although I don't know, person wouldn't be the right way to describe him. But the point is, though, whenever we blame shift, whenever we try to say, well, it's not me, or it wasn't my fault, or I'm not responsible for it, well, it's worse than we can imagine. Why? Because if I'm blaming you, I'm not confessing my sin. I'm not asking for God's forgiveness. I'm not going to experience his restoration. And by the way, if you, and I doubt that it's true for most of you, but if you've fallen into that trap of thinking you're somehow a victim of all the things that are going on in your life, listen, if you belong to him, he is making all things work together for good. That doesn't sound like victimization to me. That sounds like God's working all things together for good because he says he is. And here's the worst thing about seeing yourself as a victim instead of a victor, or at least a survivor of all things, is that it puts you in sort of a helpless, hopeless position. As long as they're doing that, you'll never be okay. As long as that keeps going on, you'll never be all right. We need to be able to stand and say, okay, I don't understand these circumstances. Lord, if I'm what, I don't even know what I could have done to find myself in this mess, but you can show me. And he always knows, and he's always willing. And so ask him. But don't blame others for the suffering you're going through or the sin you find yourself in. It makes you a slave. It keeps you in slavery. It actually gives those people who may not even know you're blaming them power over you, instead of letting God just say, okay, Lord, I know that I'm in your hands. I know you don't allow anything you don't use for my good and the good of others. I'm going to trust you even though I don't understand you, not in this situation. Well, verse 3, as I live, says the Lord God, you shall no longer use this proverb in Israel. Behold, all souls are mine. The soul of the Father as well as the soul of the Son is mine. The soul who sins shall die. But if a man is just and does what is lawful and right, if he's not eaten on the mountains or lifted up his eyes to the idols of the house of Israel, nor defiled his neighbor's wife, nor approached a woman during her impurity, if he's not oppressed anyone, but has restored to the debtor his pledge, has robbed no one by violence, but has given his bread to the hungry, covered the naked with clothing, if he's not exacted usury or taken any increase, but has withdrawn his hand from iniquity and executed true judgment between man and man, if he's walked in my statutes and kept my judgments faithfully, he is just. He shall surely live, says the Lord God. So he starts out there in verse 3 saying, listen, there's this proverb going around, you know, and he says, I don't want to hear any more of it, right? The proverb was, the fathers ate sour grapes, the children's teeth are set on edge. He says, I'm sick of hearing that. And he says, you're all mine. Fathers are mine, you're mine. And the soul who sins shall die. And it couldn't be clearer. By the way, we do what we do because of what we are. He says, if a man is just and does what's lawful and right, that will be the proof he's just. See, the doing is the proof of the heart being right with the Lord. And so, again, he's saying it's not your father's fault. It's not your wife's fault. It's not your boss's fault or your kid's fault. I'm dealing with you personally and individually. So the second issue here, of course, is that they attempt to avoid taking responsibility for their sin and suffering. And it's a reminder, God's punishment is just. They said it was unjust. It's deserved. They said it was undeserved. The truth is we are responsible. God holds us accountable for our choices, our decisions, our lifestyles, our sin. Our submission and obedience, again, evidence of a right relationship with God. And so he gives us that. You know, we read it in verse 6. I read all the way to the end of this little section just for continuity. But if he's not eating on the mountains, that's not like bad to go, you know, hunting or up on the mountains and eat while you're there. But he's talking about eating unto idols, offering things to idols, and then they would feast on those things. They often did that at the top of high places, lifting up his eyes to the idols of the house of Israel, defiling his neighbor's wife or approaching a woman during her impurity. Again, idolatry and immorality, they are again and again and again and again presented together in Scripture. And I like this because he says, if he's not done this, and if he hasn't done this, and if he hasn't done this, it's a reminder that not everybody makes the wrong choices. Joseph in Egypt, house of Potiphar, his wife coming on to Joseph day after day, ends up saying to her, how could I do this great wickedness and sin against God? Daniel in Babylon, they change, and we'll study him next, but they changed his status. I mean, he went from someone to a slave. His language, his appearance, his everything, but they couldn't change or corrupt him. So it would have been easy for Joseph to say, look, man, under these circumstances, or Daniel to say, well, you know, life's hard in Babylon. You got to go along to get along. But he never did that. He maintained his integrity. There are two who did that, and there are so many more in Scripture. The lack of oppression, the ministry of restoring to others, not robbing, you know, but instead giving. I like that because it's like not oppression, but restoration. Not robbing, but giving. Covering the naked with clothing. Not taking from them or, you know, building your own thing on their backs. But withdrawing his hand from iniquity, we read it there in verse 8, executing true judgment between man and man, walking in his statutes, keeping his judgments. He says he is just, he surely shall live, says the Lord God. Now, verses 7 through 20, they walk us through three generations. We already read the first part of this. First generation is good. Second generation is evil. Third generation is good. So he's pointing something else out because one of the problems I have, and I'm sure you guys have it too, is we tend to you know, overemphasize what's happening right now. You know, we can't help it. It's just sort of our nature. But when God looks at a man or a woman or a family, he thinks generationally. It's not just about what I can do now, or what my father did before me, or what my son may do after me. He's looking at multiple generations. So his plans are sort of in the long view of thing and of things, and we can get all caught up in, oh my gosh, what's happened? And that's why I think he does this very thing here. He gives us a godly example. The guy, verse 7, who hasn't oppressed, he has restored, he's not a robber, he's generous, you know, he clothes the naked, all those good things, right? If he says, and then he says in verse 10, if he begets a son who is a robber or a shedder of blood, who does any of these things and does none of the duties, but is eaten on the mountains or defiled his neighbor's wife or oppressed the poor and needy, robbed by violence, nor restored the pledge, lifted his eyes to idols, committed abominations. If he's exacted usury or taken increase, shall he then live? He shall not live. And if he has done any of these abominations, he shall surely die. His blood shall be upon him. Now, track with me on this because it gets interesting. I'll give you a couple good examples of how this played out in their history locally. Even semi-recently, and so we're almost there. So here's a couple things to chew on. Being a godly parent doesn't guarantee godly children. I'm not suggesting it's not, you know, the call. Be the best example we can be. Teach our children to know the difference between right and wrong, especially in this generation. It was always important, but this is a generation that either substitutes wrong for right and right for wrong or denies there is any difference. But we need to know rebellion's in the heart of every child. So we're to instruct our kids. We're to teach our kids and make sure kids and grandkids, they know right from wrong. They know good and they know evil and they have an example of it, instruction related to it, and discipline when necessary to help it sink in when it's not. But here's what we need to be sure of. There's not an absolute guarantee that a godly father produces a godly son, or that a godless father cannot produce a godly son. Because the truth is, God's dealing with each of those people and each generation, though he's seeing the long haul and he's interested in everyone walking with him, and we'll see it at the end of this chapter. It could not be clearer to say, well, you know, if it's not working out the way we think it should and the way we're praying it will, we should just keep on praying and keep on planting and keep on being an example. Because he goes on, verse 14, you'll see it. If, however, he begets a son, and this he is, we're traveling through generations. It's not talking about the same guy. We're talking about one generation after another. If he begets a son who sees all the sins which his father has done, that's how we know this is the grandson, because grandpa was godly. Dad was not godly. Now the next generation's there, and he sees the sins of his fathers. He considers, but does not do likewise. Who's not eaten on the mountains or lifted his eyes to the idols of the house of Israel, defiled his neighbor's wife, not oppressed anyone, nor withheld a pledge, nor robbed by violence, but has given his bread to the hungry, covered the naked with clothing, withdrawn his hand from the poor, and not received usury or increase, but has executed my judgments and walked in my statutes. He shall not die for the iniquity of his father. He shall surely live. I jotted, and I believe it because it's in Scripture, the wise man sees the pit and avoids it. God always says, watch out, look out, don't go. That's not the way to go. This is the way to walk. Walk in it. So those who were raised by rebellious sinners aren't doomed. It's so important. They can choose for themselves to follow in their sinful father's footsteps, or in the father's footsteps, in the footsteps of our Lord and Savior Jesus. Why is this important? Because I look at the generation that's raising the youngest generation now, and there's a whole generation of people who are just, they're oblivious to things that I just grew up knowing. You know, there's right and wrong, there's good and bad, there's light and dark, there's a God who created us and loves us and sent his son for us. There was no time in my life I didn't have that information or believe it to be true. I didn't always act or live as if I believed it. That was my own sin. That was my own fault. It wasn't my father's fault. Nor if I had continued in my sin, would have that been on him. And so here's what I'm saying. If you're a father, if you're a mom, or you hope to be, you want to live such a life that your kids will walk with the Lord. But if they walk away, just keep loving them, keep investing them in them, keep praying for them, because you don't know that they won't turn back. And you know this, God loves them more than you love them. But if you weren't raised to know the truth and to love the Lord and all those things, never justify anything because of that. While the father should lead his children to the Lord and mothers should lead their children to the Lord, in my family, I came to the Lord and then my dad came to the Lord and my sis and my wife and you know the story, many of you. I was first in my family. But I wasn't like, well, my dad didn't do his job. Why should I bother with him? I was born again. I wanted him to know the freedom and the love and the joy and the peace I'd found in Jesus. And so I didn't do it all right in the beginning. Most of us don't. I was a little foolish and you know, accusing. But nevertheless, he came to the Lord. And so while it's best for it to go this way, remember, he's given us three generations here. We have a father, then we have a son, and we have another father, you know, another son who becomes a father himself. And so verse 18 says, as for his father, because he cruelly oppressed, robbed his brother by violence, did what is not good among his people, behold, he shall die for his iniquity. This is assuming, of course, that his dad, unlike my dad, never repented. My dad did. So we're going to both be in heaven together. And he got there first. And that's, I guess, right. He's my dad. I didn't want to go first. But yet you say, why should the son not bear the guilt of the father? Because the son has done what's lawful and right. And he's kept all my statutes and observed them. And he shall surely live. The soul who sins shall die. The son shall not bear the guilt of the father, nor the father bear the guilt of the son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon himself. The wickedness of the wicked shall be upon himself. They knew this. It was in their law. Now I mention verse 7, back in verse 7, this section, verses 7 through 20, deals with three generations. So the ifs linking one generation to the next, they're not mere possibilities, they're realities. And here's an example. King Hezekiah was a godly king. He had a son who followed him on the throne who was named Manasseh, who was an exceedingly wicked king. But later he has a son named Josiah who becomes one of Israel's most godly and greatest kings. So we just read, you know, father, son, grandson, and those three are an example of the very principles he's laying out. God dealt with each generation independently, though his desire is that all generations would have walked with him. So in these last few verses, I'll just lay out the bullet points that we'll develop as we look at them. First, in verses 21 through 23, there's hope for the wicked. There's hope for the wicked. If a wicked man turns from all his sins, which he's committed, keeps all my statutes, does what is lawful and right, he shall surely live. He shall not die. None of the transgressions which he's committed shall be remembered against him. Because of the righteousness which he has done, he shall live. Do I have any pleasure at all that the wicked should die, says the Lord God, and not that he should turn from his ways and live? By the way, we know the answer to this question, but just in case you don't, hang on, because it's going to be just ahead in verse 32. Verse 24, a warning to those who are outwardly righteous, but who turn from doing what's right and live in sin. He says, when a righteous man, and he's talking about those who were doing what's right, so they would be considered so, turns away from his righteousness, commits iniquity, does according to the abominations that the wicked man does, shall he live? All the righteousness with which he's done shall not be remembered because of the unfaithfulness of which he's guilty and the sin which he has committed. Because of them he shall die. Yet you say, verse 25, the way of the Lord is not fair. Hear now, O house of Israel, is it not my way which is fair and your ways which are not fair? By the way, if this were a song, these words would be the chorus, because he's going to say it again in verse 29. But when a righteous man, verse 26, turns away from his righteousness, commits iniquity, and dies in it. Don't miss this. Even when the righteous turn away and do iniquity, there's still opportunity to repent and get it right and be right. But not once we die in it, see? When someone dies in their sin, then they are separated from him. He says, it is because of the iniquity which he has done that he dies. The wages of sin is death, but God's gift is life. Again, when a wicked man turns away from the wickedness, verse 27, which he's committed and does what's right, lawful and right, he preserves himself alive because he considers and turns away from the transgressions which he's committed. He shall surely live. He shall not die. True repentance always leads to forgiveness, restoration. There's an evidence of a heart that's right, and that will be a lifestyle that testifies that lifestyle of holiness. Verse 29, yet the house of Israel says, as we read earlier, the way of the Lord is not fair. O house of Israel, is it not my ways which are fair and your ways which are not fair? Listen, God is beyond fair. He's righteous. He's holy. He's just. He's merciful. Therefore, and we're almost there, I will judge you, O house of Israel, everyone according to his ways. Everyone means each of you individually, says the Lord God. Repent and turn from all your transgressions so that iniquity will not be your ruin. That could be a word for some tonight. If you realize you're going the wrong way, turn it around, confess it, repent of it. Walk toward the Lord instead of running from the Lord. Cast away from you. He shows what this looks like, by the way, this repentance, this turning. Cast away from you all the transgressions which you've committed and get yourselves a new heart and a new spirit. For why should you die, O house of Israel? Again and again, he brings us back to man's greatest need, a new heart and a new spirit. Not just reformation, but life, regeneration. And he answers the question he asked earlier. Can I take pleasure? Do I take pleasure in the death of the wicked? He says, verse 32, I have no pleasure in the death of one who dies, says the Lord God. Therefore, turn and live. Repent, choose life, turn from sin, and find your life in him. Lord, I'm so grateful for the continual reminders that though we're influenced by our culture, though we're influenced by those who raised us, though we're influenced by those who taught us and were examples to us. If they were good examples, we have so much to be grateful for. If they taught us the truth, we're so grateful to you and to them. But for those of us that wouldn't have that testimony tonight, Lord, we're just so grateful that it's not about what happened to us or who raised us or how they did that. It's the choices we've made and the choices we're making. And Lord, if tonight any of your kids here are suffering because of their own sin, Lord, show them. Open eyes, soften hearts, remind them you're for them and not against them. And that these things that they're going through, well, you want to use them for good. That's going to happen, Lord, as they turn back to you and confess that the mess they're in It's a mess they caused. It's the result of their sin. I pray for those, Lord, who are suffering as a result of being connected to those who are rebelling against you. And there are many, Lord, who love you and are doing right by you and in your sight, but are just heartbroken over the decisions of those we love and that we pray for. And Lord, we know you love them more than we love them. And we pray you'll have your way in them. Finally, if you're here tonight and you need to get things right, it may be that you, like me, have always known there's a God who made you and loves you and sent his son to suffer and die for you. But maybe you have never said, Jesus, come into my life, be my Lord, be my Savior, forgive my every sin. And Jesus said, you must, in fact, do that. Unless a man, a woman, a boy, or a girl be born again, spiritually, eternally, you'll never see the kingdom of God. And the alternative is something you want to avoid at all costs. If tonight you want to say, Jesus, forgive me, I repent of my sin, I confess my sin, I own it, I ask forgiveness for it, I'm not going to blame anyone else anymore, but I'm asking your forgiveness. If that's you, you want to give your life to him, I'd ask you to raise your hand, hold it high. Awesome, I see your hand there. Wonderful. Anybody else want to say, me too, right here, right now? Not another moment without the Lord. Not one more moment without knowing I'm right, forgiven, cleansed, right with the Lord. Anybody else before we pray? You who raised your hand and anyone else wants to pray along, pray aloud after me. Heavenly Father, thank you for loving me. For loving me first. For choosing me. For drawing me. For convicting me of my sin. And convincing me of your love. And the perfection of your plan. To save me. From myself and from my sin. Lord, I confess the wages of sin is death. And I ask for life, forgiveness, your will for me, in me, through me. I trust in your son, Jesus, who died for my sin, was buried and rose again. I give my life to the one who gave his life. And I thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.